I have three themes that I would very quickly sort of run through. I've got 15 minutes or 20 minutes. And the first theme is the connection between peace and development. The connection. Then secondly, where do we stand at this moment in time after 20 years of transition towards democracy? And then thirdly, the role of the NDP in this regard. Let me kick off with the first theme, the connection between peace and development. I'm currently involved with the Thabo Mbeki African Leadership Institute. I lecture on that program. And the theme of my courses, there are other courses also, but the theme of my courses is more or less the following: peace building and peacemaking within environments which suffered or have suffered not just conflict but also violence, deadly conflict where people got killed. Right across the globe, we have that phenomenon. In fact, since 1990, hundreds of peace accords were put together. Not many of them survived. They survived for 3 years, they survived for 5 years, they survived maybe for 10 years. Many of them didn't survive. And there are good reasons. Let me set it very quickly. The reasons, because there was no connection between peacemaking and peace building and sustainable development. That is the lesson right across the globe. So, in one of my courses, a student or a delegate, I call them participants, they're not students because they're between 25 and 50 years old. They come from right across Africa, from South Africa, but from Somalia, from Nigeria, from Kenya, etc. And one of the Kenyan participants made a statement last year which kept me quite busy, which I think is relevant to every single South African. He made the following statement. He said, "The absence of violence or open conflict is a bonus, but not an indication of sustainable peace. Justice is the name of the game. Justice is the name of the game." What he was talking about was what is it possible to create a just peace in an environment which was plagued by deadly conflict and violence? Two conceptions of peace. The one is what is called in the literature the negative conception of peace. The negative conception of peace is, listen, I don't like you. In fact, I'm not going even to pretend liking you. And I'm not going to make any effort to like you. But I will not kill you. That's a negative peace. There is another element also in this negative peace, which I need to, for academic purposes, explain. And that is where you have an absence of violence and conflict, but not a presence of justice, where inequality and iniquities prevail and nothing is being done to deal with it because there's no violence or there's no conflict. Positive peace, and Mr. Mandela was one of the proponents of positive peace. Positive peace, two elements: working partnerships, generating processes of sustainable development. That is what the Hope Project of Stellenbosch is all about. Mr. Mandela made a statement some time ago is that to make peace with an enemy, you have to work with that enemy so that that enemy can become your partner. You must work with that enemy. Very easy to work with friends. It's in fact very easy to talk to friends. My themes, the theme that I had to develop a couple of weeks ago in Washington was talking to the enemy, making peace, not with friends, but with enemies. And that was Mr. Mandela's position. And then the second point I just quickly want to mention is, how do you go about to get rid of the construct of the enemy? Because we use this construct to mobilize, to demonize, to organize, and even to militarize. And I want to make this my position quite clear. Every single time that I hear or read about the word enemy, or that people who should be regarded as being responsible use that concept, whether it's in the Durrance or wherever, what they're doing is to undermine the peace building and peacemaking process in this country. So talking to the enemy, extremely important. Peace without development is empty, and development without peace is blind. Why plea for peace and reconciliation at the local level if visible signs of a narrowing of the justice gap regarding the delivery of services are absent? Because what we suffer from for quite some time is what is called the justice gap. At a conference on peace through commerce at Notre Dame University, which I attended, one of the speakers made a very interesting statement. And I quote, "The justice gap happens when open violence diminishes through national accords, but people's expectations for some level of incremental improvement of their basic needs are not met in practical ways. A deep sense of betrayal and a cheap political peace is often experienced." That's why you can't talk about peace if you don't talk about sustainable development. And if you don't talk about delivery at the lower end of the pyramid, not delivery at the top of the pyramid. Second point. Sam, don't get excited. I'll finish within 5 or 10 minutes. Second point. So where do we stand with our tradition, with our transition from democracy to democracy? There are four transitions, are very rough processes, very complex. In some instances, they take 20 to 50 years to run their course. Transition is not an election. An election is an event. Transitions are processes that need to be managed. It's managed revolutions, structural transformations. And it takes a lot of time, effort, and also leadership. But there's a way in which academics have succeeded in measuring the quality or the success or the failure of transitions. And that is, the first criteria is broadening and deepening of democracy. Do we experience a constitutional democracy where the president, etc., is not above the law, but is also part of those that has to deal with the constitution? I'm prepared to give South Africa 8 out of 10. We've had, it is a major success story in comparison with other transitions. Second criteria, criterium, we weet toch wat ik bedoel, is wealth creation. Nie geleende geld nie, Not borrowed, created. That's very interesting, and I got this from the Unilever Foundation. The black middle class comprises 4.2 million people. Now, middle class is defined by the Unilever Institute as those earning a monthly income of 15,000 rand, plus, 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 going up higher with a motor car, a house, etc., etc. 4.2 million. It's a huge increase. Total spending power of this black middle class is 420 billion rand. The white middle class, 2.8 million. Total spending power, 380 billion. The white middle class is a stagnating middle class. Except, at this point, they still, the wealth is still concentrated there in terms of buying power. And that is what the Unilever. Now, and I think South Africa in her transition has done quite well. I think it's really a success story. The third criterion is equitable distribution of wealth. Equitable. We failed. In that exam, we failed. Imagine a pyramid and where you are on that pyramid. And but I'm talking about the bottom of the pyramid. Now, two sort of segments at the bottom of the pyramid. At the lower end, one gets what has been called the wretched of the earth, the poorest of the poor. And then just on top of them, we can call them the informal entrepreneurial class. They try anything to earn a living. And close to 40% of our total population belongs to that lower part of the pyramid. That is not the issue. The issue is that at the lower end of that pyramid, people are getting younger and blacker and less educated. So if we talk about sustainable development, we have to ask ourselves the question, do we have the policies and the projects in place to deal with this very fragile lower end of the pyramid? Because peace has to do with sustainable development, not at the top, but at the middle and at the lower part of the pyramid. Fourth element, social cohesion, nation building, national identity. I had the privilege to attend a conference in the middle of last year in Soweto social cohesion, organized by the Department of Arts and Culture and by the minister. And I'm one of the supporters of that minister, of the minister. You can always support an individual who provides leadership without necessarily supporting the organization. Just remember that. And I think at my age, I collect all sorts of interesting qualifications. I'm an advocate for social cohesion, appointed by the department. I'm not sure what I have to do, but I like the idea. I've never been an advocate in my whole life, so I'm an advocate. But at that conference, attended by quite a number of people, it became quite clear that one of our main problems in this country is not just nation building, it's social cohesion. It's experiencing a national identity. Now, I can use the word social capital to explain it, which I'm not going to do. The issue is, which I experienced there in Soweto, I asked myself, are we really a nation celebrating a national identity despite our diversity? Are we a nation comfortable with diversity? And does South Africa experience sustainable peace? and development after 20 years of transition? My answer is, it's touch and go. It's a 50-50 on two issues we do well, on two others, and maybe the most important one, social cohesion and nation building. We're not doing quite well. So, to end my short talk, what about the future? I have an answer. A lot of other people also has an answer. The National Development Plan is one of the best policy documents we've had for the last 20 years. The World Bank makes a point, and I agree with that point. You can't have good projects in a bad policy environment. You can't have good projects in a bad policy environment. I will add something else, and you can't implement good projects without the people needed to implement those projects. And I think the National Development Plan is the sort of policy framework which will effectively address the issues of development at the lower end also of the pyramid, depending on the leadership and depending on the kind of projects developed over the next 15 to 20 years to deal with this very fragile lower part of the pyramid. So the National Development Plan, to summarize, in my opinion, deals with the connection between peace and development. I would like to conclude with something I got from Brigalia Bomb. And she's involved in all sorts of organizations, and one organization is Women in Dialogue. Because she makes the point, and I agree with that, if we don't get a national and a regional and also a local dialogue on how, on the implementation of the National Development Plan, our transition can fail, because success is not guaranteed in a transition. Brazil took quite a couple of years to get through her transition with many failures. And incidentally, it's a woman now who's fixing all the problems of Brazil. And she's visited Africa now recently on four occasions. There's a reason why she visited Africa. It's not for vacation. It's for something else. But let me conclude with Brigalia. We may have been doing many remarkable things, but we seem to have unlearned the power of real dialogue, which has served us so well in the past. We confuse dialogue with robust debate, conferences and consultations, which leave most people deflated and disillusioned. It does not include this particular conference. Our negative experiences of being in contested spaces where the battle for the supremacy of ideas destroys our ability to unite around a common vision are reinforcing a growing fatigue and a belief that it does not help to talk. Our young democracy is now entering into a phase where we can no longer ignore the value of dialogue. No longer can we rely on our struggle credentials and our past heroes. We need to become the heroes of today and tomorrow. Our legacy should not be sought in monuments for fallen heroes, but a united nation that unlocks the potential of all its people, especially the youth. And if your conference helps us to do this, it'll be a success story. Thank you.